Jiminy Crickets.
Jiminy Cricket is the name. I'm a happy-go-lucky fellow, always getting in wrong for singing my song. A merry old soul am I. Jiminy Cricket is the name. I'll be hanging around this evening. I'll be tipping my hat and telling you that Jiminy Cricket is the name.
Hello, Cricketeers, and welcome to our October Dateline. And I'm here with Ruthie. Hello, Ruthie.
Hello, Chris. Hello, Cricketeers.
This year we opted not to do a Halloween episode because we're sort of ran out of Halloween ideas. So there's been a major news event within the Disney fan community that we've been wanting to cover, and so we decided to just go ahead and do that. And that event is the loss of Richard Sherman a couple months ago. We're gonna do a extensive tribute to his life and legacy, as well as a Sherman Brothers top 10 list. So are you ready to get started, Ruthie?
Let's go.
So this week, or this episode, we could not hold it down to just 10 because there are so many choices within this topic. So once again, this is going to be a top 30. And the category for our top 30, if you haven't guessed already, is going to be the top 30 Sherman Brothers Disney songs. We had to qualify Disney because they did do a lot of work outside of Disney, and we wanted to keep our list to 30. Like, if we opened it up, it would be like top 50.
Yeah, and so, 30 was hard, so.
Yeah. And we ended up combining things within some of the numbering, as like we did like the soundtrack for this movie, because we couldn't narrow it down to just one song. So do you want to go first, Ruthie?
Sure, I'll go first.
Okay, what is our number? And this, again, disclaimer, this is Ruthie and Chris Linden's list. This is not your list. This is nobody's opinion but ours. So if you disagree, you're allowed to, because this is just our opinion. So don't be hurt if we don't mention your favorite song. This is just our feelings on it, okay? Just want to make sure. I know a lot of people are passionate about Sherman Brothers, so.
Yeah, we are too.
What is our number 30, Ruthie?
So number 30 is the Merlin Jones song. This is the theme song from The Misadventures of Merlin Jones, which is the first movie, the first Merlin Jones movie.
Yes.
And it also has an iconic, opening sequence with the song and like the stop motion animation while Annette is singing this song.
Bill Justice and Xavier and Tencio famously did all that stop motion stuff in the early 60s for Disney. And this is no exception. And number 29 is Miracles from Molecules. Miracles from Molecules. From Adventure Through Inner Space, the attraction from the New Tomorrowland. in 1969 or 67. I don't know where my mind went crazy there. And what is next, Ruthie? This is one where we had to sort of just pick the movie because there's so many songs that are so great. We couldn't narrow it down.
So this is from the short symposium on popular songs. Mm-hmm. So we picked the soundtrack because, of course, all of the songs are really good.
And we also, when we did these combined ones, we did pick our top three.
Right.
In no particular order, but these are our top three.
So our top three for the symposium is Rutabaga Rag, Boogie Woogie Bakery Boy, and Puppy Love Is Here to Stay.
We're not saying we don't like the other songs. These are just our top three favorite from... Because this is the entire soundtrack that we're talking about. We like all the songs.
Right.
So our next selection is Follow Me Boys from 1966. The title song from Follow Me Boys, also called Follow Me Boys. And interestingly, this was the movie that was in theaters, the Disney movie, in theaters upon Walt Disney's death. So this was the last Disney film released during Walt Disney's lifetime. And the Shermans stayed on for a few years. We'll get into that. We're going to go over the whole story coming up next. So what's up next, Ruthie?
Next one is a song, A Kiss Goodnight. And this was specifically written only by Richard Sherman.
Right.
Because Robert had passed.
Yes.
At this time, in 2015, and this was for the 60th anniversary of Disneyland.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And he did quite a bit of work after his brother passed. We'll get into that, too. Next up is another score. This is all the songs they wrote for the Journey into Imagination Pavilion at Epcot, which actually only included three songs, which are in no particular order, Making Memories, Magic Journeys, and One Little Spark. And what's up next, Ruthie?
The next song is the Strummin' song, and this is from a Disney TV movie called The Horse Masters. And this is actually a song that they call the first song that the Sherman Brothers wrote under Disney contract for Disney.
And it was 61, and it was actually the second, it was a two-parter, so it was the second and third episode of The Wonderful World of Color. The first one was that one with Ludwig, where he's singing the color songs and all that. Uh-huh. And then this was the following 2 weeks after that, this aired. So this was right at the beginning of The Wonderful World of Color. And up next is Marie Chevalier. Enjoy It from In Search of the Castaways from 1962. And this was one of two... Actually... Let me rephrase it. One of three collaborations that the Sherman Brothers did with Marie Chevalier. The other two being The Aristocats and Monkeys Go Home.
Mm-hmm.
And what's up next, Ruthie?
The next one is the Orange Bird song, and this is written for in 1971 for the opening of Walt Disney World. And they actually wrote, they had an album, so it's multiple songs about the Orange Bird, but we picked the, you know, the actual one that's called Orange Bird Song.
And just to be clear, we love the song, not the singer.
Yes.
And we will move on from there. Number 21, The Best Time of Your Life, which was the second version of the song for Carousel of Progress that they wrote for the Walt Disney World version, which premiered in Florida in 1975.
All right. The next one is another soundtrack.
Uh-huh.
And this is for the one and only Genuine Original Family Band.
Yeah.
Which is 1967?
Eight,
okay. 1968. And we picked our top three songs. Mm-hmm. Of course, the whole soundtrack is good, and there's many more songs besides these three. But we picked 10 Feet Off the Ground, About Time, and West of the Wide Missouri.
Right. So the next one is another one where we had multiple songs. They did not write every song for this film.
Right.
Probably the most famous song from the movie, Everybody Wants to Be a Cat, was not written by the Sherman Brothers. And I always thought it was, and I only recently, within the past few years, was corrected and told, because I was like, written by the Sherman Brothers, hello?
No.
Other people online corrected me. Mm-hmm. So I stand corrected. But the three songs that they wrote that appeared in the film, because they did write another one that was cut, are The Aristocats, Scales and Arpeggios, and Thomas O'Malley. And the fourth one that they wrote was She Never Felt Alone, which is another great song, but it was cut from the film. I would love it if someday they reanimated that segment and put it back in. That would be great. Mm-hmm. I always feel like it needs to be there. It feels like it's missing.
Mm-hmm.
The scene where it's supposed to go feels like it's something needs to be there that isn't there.
Yeah.
I always felt that way.
It's like what is drawing them back to that, to their owner in the house.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what's up next, Ruthie?
Next is a song from Sword in the Stone, the 1963 animated film.
Yes, you got that.
Okay. This is Higgidus Figgidus. And this is probably the most famous song from this film.
Right.
They did write other songs as well for this.
This was the first animated feature they did for Disney. And they wrote these songs, I believe, before they did a lot of the other things that came out before this did.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Next up is Mr. Piano Man from the 1962 episode of The Wonderful World of Color called The Golden Horseshoe. And this was like a tribute to the 60,000th or something like that performance of The Golden Horseshoe. And they had special guest stars, including Annette. And she sang three original songs, all written by the Sherman Brothers. But the standout would be Mr. Piano Man.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right, next up we have another soundtrack, and this is for the 1967 film, The Happiest Millionaire.
Mm-hmm.
This is the last film that Walt Disney worked on, but it did come out after his death.
Yeah.
And we picked three songs, but of course this soundtrack actually has a lot of songs on it.
Yeah.
That the Sherman Brothers wrote all of them.
Yeah, they wrote the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we picked three, Fortuosity, of course, Are We Dancing, and Let's Have a Drink on It.
Next up is the title song for That Darn Cat, and the name of that song is That Darn Cat. And in the film, it was performed by Bobby Darin, famous jazz performer. And before that, he was a rock and roll singer, and then he sort of transitioned into jazz in his later career. So, interestingly, the album did not include Bobby Darin, and I think it was for contractual reasons, because I don't think his record label would allow him to record a song for Disneyland's label.
Mm-hmm.
So he only appeared in the film. And the album version, there's two versions. One by a singer that was doing stuff for Disney at that time, Billy Strange. And then the other version is actually with Louis Prima.
Mm.
So it's the same orchestration for the album version, but there's two versions with two singers.
Hmm. Interesting. All right, the next song is The Monkey's Uncle. And this is the theme song from the movie The Monkey's Uncle, and this is the second Merlin Jones movie. And this is, Annette sings this song, and the Beach Boys actually back her up on this song.
Yes. There was supposed to be another Merlin Jones film, and Tommy Kirk had a falling out with Walt, and it didn't end up happening because of that. So it could have been a trilogy.
Yeah.
So, next up, another Annette tune, Pineapple Princess, from the album Hawaiianette from 1960. Probably her second biggest hit.
Mm-hmm.
We will be mentioning her first biggest hit in a moment.
Yes. But the next song is the Spectrum song. This is from the Disneyland anthology series and sung by Ludwig von Drake.
Paul Frees as Ludwig von Drake. Next up is another soundtrack score, and this is Bedknobs and Broomsticks. Our top three picks are The Old Home Guard, The Age of Not Believing, and The Beautiful Briny Sea. And as we said before, Ruthie.
Yes. So this is Annette's most popular song, Tall Paul.
Yes.
And the Sherman Brothers wrote this, and this was before they actually worked for Disney. And this song was how Walt Disney kind of got to know who they were, and they came on the scene for him through this song.
Yes. Some would argue it's not officially Disney, but I disagree.
Yes, I disagree as well.
Next up, again, is another, because they wrote multiple songs for The Parent Trap. And so The Parent Trap soundtrack is our number 9 from 1961. So we've got the song, the title song, The Parent Trap, For Now, For Always, and Let's Get Together. Of course, that would be probably the most famous song from the film. Mm-hmm.
We have another soundtrack. This is one of our favorite movies at this podcast, Summer Magic. And this another one that has quite a few songs, and they wrote all of them. Mm-hmm. But we picked our top three is Beautiful Beulah, The Ugly Bug Ball, and On the Front Porch.
Next up is the title, the theme song from The Wonderful World of Color TV series, A Carousel of Color, which premiered in the fall of 1961.
The next one is the Tiki 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 Room, and people might not realize that this was written by the Sherman Brothers because none of the other songs are in the attraction. But yes, Walt had them write a catchy theme song, and this is the one that they came up with, and we can still go to Disneyland and Walt Disney World and hear it today.
Actually, this was interesting, and this is something I only recently figured out, and Ruthie actually is the person who pointed it out for me. There's a song from a 1961 episode of the, or 1960 episode of the Walt Disney Anthology program, and it was still called Walt Disney Presents, called Escape to Paradise, and it was to promote the Swiss Family Robinson coming out in theaters, and it included a song called Swiss Family Calypso. And it was basically the same song as what would later be the Tiki 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 Room. So they basically just recycled an earlier tune and added different lyrics to it, and the rest is history.
Yes. And we know which one is more famous.
Yes. So up next is the soundtrack again to The Jungle Book. And our top three, they did not write all the songs. Really, the only song that's in the movie that they did not write is The Bare Necessities. So that's why it's not listed here, because it's definitely my favorite song from the movie. But the three songs we picked that they did write are Trust in Me, I Want to Be Like You, and that's what friends are for. Not to be confused with the 80s song.
The Dionne Warwick one?
Yeah, right.
Definitely not. They don't sound remotely
anything
close
alike
to each other.
Yeah, right.
All right, we do have another soundtrack. Of course, this is one of their most famous soundtracks, is Winnie the Pooh, from multiple Winnie the Pooh shorts that then were combined into one film. Mm-hmm. And we picked our top three from all of the Winnie the Pooh songs. We picked the theme song, Winnie the Pooh, The Wonderful Thing About Tiggers, and Heffalumps and Woozles.
Okay. Our number three is the original Carousel of Progress theme song, There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow, from the 1964 World's Fair.
This is our last soundtrack, and of course, this is the reason why we ended up having to do soundtracks, because there's absolutely
no way
that we could pick any one song from Mary Poppins.
Right.
So, of course, this is iconic. They won Academy Awards for their music for this film. And the top three that we picked is A Spoonful of Sugar, Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, and Chim Chim Cheree.
Which is the song that they won for best song. And then, of course, the number one Sherman Brother song is It's a Small World, which you're actually listening to the music right now. And this was originally from the 1964 World's Fair. There's a funny story where one of the Sherman Brothers, it was probably Richard, said that they wanted to donate the proceeds from this song to the UNICEF organization, which was the United Nations Children's Fund, which the attraction itself was funding, was creating. The revenue from the attraction went to them. And Walt Disney said, don't you dare do that. This song is going to put your kids through college.
And was he right? Yeah.
Yeah, right.
They say they say that the sun never sets on this song because it's always playing in some park around the world.
It's true. So now we're going to do our extensive tribute to Richard Sherman, specifically Richard Sherman, but of course, because they work together, we will be talking a lot about Robert as well. So let's get started.
Yeah.
Anytime now. There we go. So, Ruthie has put together an outline, and I created a ton, literally, of images. So, Ruthie's going to tell the story of Richard Sherman, and I'm going to show pictures and rudely interrupt her constantly with my takes on whatever it is that she says. So, do you want to get started, Ruthie?
Sure. Let's get started with Richard Sherman. So he was born Richard Morton Sherman on June 12th, 1928 in New York City. And his parents are Russian Jewish immigrants. And his mother was Rosa, and his dad was Al Sherman. And Al Sherman was known to be at the time a successful popular composer, and the specific type of music that he wrote were songs from Tin Pan Alley, which you could probably step in on this, but from what I understand, it's songs that like positive songs to help bring people up during like the Great Depression and stuff like that.
Yes, that is true, but that's not specifically what Tin Pan Alley is. Tin Pan Alley refers to the street in New York where all of the songwriters were located. And when you would walk down the street, you would hear all these pianos playing at once, all different things, and it sounded like a bunch of tin pans crashing together. So they named the street Tin Pan Alley, and this is where all the pop songs of the 20s, really from the turn of the century up until the 40s, were written. And famous songwriters such as George and Ira Gershwin, Irving Berlin, and all those types of famous songwriters worked on Tin Pan Alley, as did Al Sherman. And so the types of songs that were popular in the 30s were what Ruthie described. So yeah, they were writing those types of songs because that was the trend, but that's not specifically what Tin Pan Alley refers to. Mm-hmm. And so these songs that you're looking at are the sheet music, are some of the songs that Al Sherman wrote. And the three most well-known are You Gotta Be a Football Hero, which is really faint. Like, you hear that song all the time when, like, you're showing football stuff, you know.
Like old clips and stuff?
Yes. And No, No, A Thousand Times No. And then the other one is was actually recorded by a very famous singer from the 1920s named Eddie Cantor. He was like the Madonna of the 20s. Like, that's how famous. He was like one of the biggest singers at that time. Hmm. Who's the woman that's famous right now?
Taylor Swift?
Yes, he was the Taylor. That's a better reference.
Yes.
He was the Taylor Swift of the 1920s. Anyway, he sang famously one of Al Sherman's songs. Potatoes are cheaper, tomatoes are cheaper, now's the time to fall in love, which is a very Depression era. I guess this song is from the 30s, not the 20s. But it's like very Depression era. And later, the Shermans would write a song for Disney that paid homage to that song, believe it or not. So, go ahead, Ruthie.
Alrighty. So, following 7 years of frequent cross-country moves, the Sherman family finally settled down in Beverly Hills, California in 1937. Mm-hmm. And so that makes Richard about 9 at that time. And then so he grew up in Beverly Hills area. Of course, it was completely different area at the time than what you think of Beverly Hills now. Yes. And so, of course, he grew up and went to Beverly Hills High School. And this is where he first started falling in love with music. He studied piano and flute and piccolo. And then following his high school graduation, or no, I'm sorry, actually
upon.
At his high school, at his high school graduation, which was 1946, Richard and his classmate Andre Previn played a musical duet with Previn on the piano and Sherman on the flute. And you might know the name Andre Previn because he would go on to become a noted composer, and he adapted the score for the film My Fair Lady, among other things.
Among many, many other things.
Yes.
And I know him because my father had a lot of his records, like of his compositions, which were all popular songs from the 40s and 50s and 60s. And he was huge. He was a big, big famous band leader during that time, and put out numerous records and did some big things like My Fair Lady, among other things, as Ruthie said.
Yes.
So that he was in very good company with Andre Previn, that's for sure.
Definitely. So after he graduated high school, you know, the next thing he decided to do was go to college. Actually, I didn't put this in the outline, but I found out this during research is Richard went to Bard College in the late 1940s, which is a liberal arts college in upstate New York. And actually, Robert went there as well. So they were there at the same time.
Right, yeah. I learned that through later things you mentioned in your outline.
Yeah. So Richard majored in music, and he wrote numerous sonatas and art songs during his time at college. So, you know, he fell in love with music in high school and continued his love through college. And also during the Richard's time at college, he met a woman that he fell in love with. Her name was Corrine Newman. And they got married and they had one child, Linda. But unfortunately, the marriage didn't end up working out. Mm-hmm. So now they both graduated. And within 2 years of graduating college, Richard and Robert began writing songs together on a challenge from their father. So what they were actually living together back in California. They went back to California after finishing college in New York, and they were living together in a an apartment, and their father came over there, you know, and he, you know, like parents do, what are you doing with your life? What are you going to do? And then he knew that they had the ability to make music. Now, Robert was not really musical, but he was a writer. So, which is why he's like the lyricist, and then Richard is the musician who and then they work together to create the songs. Right. And so he knew that about them, and so he challenged them to become songwriters. Mm-hmm. And so in 1951, they wrote a song called Gold Can Buy You Anything But Love. And this was their first record, and it was recorded by Gene Autry,
famous cowboy crooner. And also, I'm gathering, I don't know the song, I haven't heard it, but just from the title alone, I'm guessing it's a spoof of another song from the 20s called I Can't Give You Anything But Love. Because the title Gold Can Buy You Anything But Love sounds sort of spoofy. Mm. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking it was a spoof of that song from the 20s. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in 1953, Richard was drafted into the U.S. Army. And he was assigned to the Army Band and Glee Club, and he served as the musical conductor for both groups from 1953 until his honorable discharge in 1955. He was stationed solely in the United States during his time in service, and he never saw any war or anything like that. He never left the United States.
Right.
So also, earlier, before college, Robert was went into the I'm not sure if he went into the Navy. He went into the to the a branch of the military and served there for a couple of years during World War II. And then so during this time when Richard was gone, Robert actually wrote songs with another songwriter at this time. So he continued to work on his musical career. And then in 1957, Richard married Ursula Elizabeth Gluck, and the couple had two children, Gregory Vincent and Victoria Lynn. So that is his wife. There's a picture of his wife right there. Obviously not an older picture. This is a newer one. And then in 1958, Robert founded the music publishing company Music World Corporation, which would later work with Disney's BMI publishing arm, Wonderland Music Company. So this was one of the things that Robert did on his own without Richard. Mm-hmm. But they were, again, working on music together, and that same year, they had their first top 10 hit with Tall Paul, which was sung by Annette Funicello. We talked about that in the, you know, to the top 30. The success of that song attracted the attention of the Walt Disney Studio, and the Shermans were contracted to write several more songs and create concept albums for Annette, including Hawaiianette and Italianette in 1960 and Danceanette in 1961. So they wrote all the songs for those albums.
Mm-hmm. Or adapted, because some of the songs were traditional Italian or Hawaiian songs, and they reworked them and added modern lyrics. Same with Dancinette. Some of those songs already existed, and they added new lyrics for Annette. And some were original songs.
Right. Another one of the songs that was popular during this time that they wrote is Pineapple Princess for the Hawaiian album. Pineapple Princess,
Dancinette, Dream Boy, lots of very popular songs. And that was very popular at this time.
Yes, yes. Alrighty, so in 1961, the Shermans contributed several songs for the Walt Disney television series anthology show, including the new theme song for The Wonderful World of Color, which we talked about, and its new character, Ludwig von Drake. We talked about one of his songs, the Spectrum song, but he wrote many more Ludwig songs, or they wrote many more Ludwig songs.
And also, we talked about the title song, The Carousel of Color, which they wrote. So you skipped a bullet point. The popularity of these recordings by Annette. You want to read that to our audience?
Yeah. I did skip a bullet point. So the popularity of the Annette songs, all the albums that we just talked about, impressed Walt Disney. And in early 1960s, he hired the Sherman Brothers as the very first staff songwriters for Walt Disney Productions.
Yeah.
And then, so one of the first things they did under contract was this Walt Disney anthology music.
Right.
So some of the other projects that they worked on in the beginning years of their time at Disney include the Horse Masters television movie from 1961. We talked about that song, the strumming song. The Absent-Minded Professor and The Parent Trap. Those are also from 1961. From 1962, they did music for the film Bon Voyage, the short A Symposium on Popular Song, and the films In Search of the Castaways, Big Red, and Moon Pilot.
My favorite.
And then for Yes, I know, your favorite. That's your favorite song, too.
No, I like the song. That's the one thing I like about the movie, is the song. The Seven Moons of Beta Lare.
And then 1963, they did music for Summer Magic and The Sword and the Stone.
Right.
And then something that we already talked about in our top 30. At the same time in 1963, they composed the theme song for the Tiki Room attraction at Disneyland.
Yes. And of course, we talked about how they originally did work for the anthology program, and this grew out of the work they did for the anthology program. That was really their first assignment. They also wrote three songs about Disneyland for the anthology program. First one was All Aboard the Mine Train, which was to promote the new Nature's Wonderland Mine Train. Then they wrote a song called Disneyland 61. And then they wrote a song called Every Day's a Holiday in Disneyland, USA. So those were three other early songs written by the Sherman Brothers for the anthology. And the first songs they wrote about Disneyland specifically. So this was not their first Disneyland adjacent assignment.
Right. And I'm sure all of those songs are on your site.
Oh, yes, they are.
Including the Tiki Room, of course.
No, that's one I don't have.
You don't have that, yeah.
Yeah, specifically, I don't have that one. Yeah. For personal reasons.
All right. Yes. Well, now we are at 1964, which is basically the pinnacle of their career at Walt Disney. Mm-hmm. This year, they wrote what is perhaps their most recognizable song, It's a Small World After All. Along with the song, There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow for Disney attractions in the 1964-65 World's Fair, New York World's Fair.
Right.
And, of course, both of those songs would go on to become attractions at Disneyland, and then they would continue to be the theme songs for those attractions. Mm-hmm. And then that same year, they also provided the music for the live-action animated musical film Mary Poppins. I mean, what can you say about this? I mean, this is one of Disney's most popular films, and it would not be without their music.
They not only wrote the songs, but they developed the story. Like, yeah. They were heavily involved in the creative development of the movie, not just the songs.
Mm-hmm.
Like, some of the songs they wrote dictated the scenes that mm-hmm. appeared in the film. And they also famously worked with Mary Travers.
Pamela Linden.
Mm-hmm. Can't forget the Linden part. Pamela Linden Travers. They were her collaborative people when she visited the Disney studio.
Mm-hmm.
There's actually a movie about that we might mention later.
The other thing is, like, so one of the things that, about the Sherman brothers and Walt, they had a very special relationship, and mm-hmm. Walt leaned on them heavily during mm-hmm. his last years at the studio.
Right.
And so the thing about Mary Poppins is that he handed them the book
mm-hmm.
because, you know, famously Walt Disney wanted to make this film because his daughters loved the story of Mary Poppins.
Right.
And he handed the boys the book, and he's like, read through this, you know, let me see if you can, you know, pull anything out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so they read through the book, it went back to Walt, and they had underlined specific chapters that they liked there that they felt like they could develop into stories in a movie mm-hmm. and write songs about it. And when they went back to Walt, he opened his copy of the book and their copy of the book, and they had underlined the same chapters. So
yes.
They were exactly on the same wavelength as Walt.
Right.
So there was a couple of other things they did in 1964. Which they did the music for The Misadventures of Merlin Jones and The Moon Spinners.
Yes. I'd say even more famous than Mary Poppins, both of those.
Sure. Alrighty. So now we're on to 1965, and still, again, significant with Mary Poppins. They won 2 Academy Awards for Mary Poppins, Best Original Score, which obviously included Feed the Birds, Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, mm-hmm. and their best original song, Chim Chim Cheree.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's true.
And then, yes. And while they were developing the music, you know, of course, this was not a quick process. And, you know, and if you watch the movie that about how they developed, well, we'll talk about it later. I mean, it's not really a secret. But, you can see it was not a quick process. They met with P.L. Travers over a few weeks and, you know, showed that their ideas for songs. They also went to Walt. You know, she didn't like any of them, but it didn't matter because Walt was going to do whatever he was going to do.
Yeah.
And
she didn't like anything.
Yeah, she didn't like anything that they came up with.
Or that anybody ever came up with, except
right.
for her.
Right. I mean, they were trying to make this, you know, she wrote Mary Poppins as a little bit more stern and not, you know, not very friendly or loving. And they
right.
obviously could not make a movie about somebody like that. So, you know,
right.
you have to still make a character movie friendly.
Yes.
And that's what she didn't understand. So.
Among many other things.
Right.
Didn't understand much.
Yes.
Outside of her own scope.
It's like a miracle that Walt got her to agree to give him the rights. It is.
Yeah.
But while they were developing the music, one of the songs that they came up with is Feed the Birds. And this ended up being, like, when they played it for Walt originally, he heard it and he was like, well, that's what this whole movie is about.
Mm-hmm.
And so from then on, he loved that song. And he would, on Fridays, you know, end of the week, you're trying to wind down, he would call the boys in to his office, and he had a piano. He had like a 2-room office, and one of the rooms had a piano. And he would just tell them to play the song, boys, and they knew exactly what he was asking, and they would play Feed the Birds.
And famously, Ruthie actually was invited into the office to play chopsticks on the piano.
Right, in 1965?
No, in 1979.
Okay.
When she was 3 years old.
No, not true. Alrighty. So, following the success of Mary Poppins, the boys, or the brothers, either way, continued to work.
Walt called them the boys.
Yes,
so.
Walt called them the boys, yeah. So, they were continuing to work directly for Walt Disney, providing music for the following projects. So, 1965, The Monkey's Uncle, the film Those Calloways, and That Darn Cat. In 1966, Winnie the Pooh and the Honey Tree, and Follow Me, Boys. 1967, The Happiest Millionaire, The Jungle Book, The Adventures of Bullwhip Griffin, and they wrote the theme song for the Adventures Through Interspace attraction that premiered in 1967 at Disneyland, which is the song Miracles from Molecules. Also 1968, they wrote the music for the one and only Genuine Original Family Band and Winnie the Pooh and the Blustery Day. Now I want to say before we go on, that is by no means an extensive list. There's
no,
more
a much
that they more. Worked on.
Yes, a lot of TV stuff and just stuff that was exclusively for albums. Mm-hmm. Like one thing we didn't mention is their album Tin Panorama, which they included all the songs from a symposium on popular songs from 1962, plus several additional songs representing other musical genres from, you know, the past 60 years in music. And the record was released in 64 as from the Mary Poppins songwriting team, so it was during Mary Poppins, and they wrote other albums, like they wrote some Winnie the Pooh songs that were just for the albums that came out, various Winnie the Pooh tunes. They also wrote songs for parades, like the 10th anniversary song for Disneyland, and another, they wrote some songs for albums that were like original story albums, like Misty the Mermaid and stuff like that, that were just album stories that were never made into films, but they wrote like the original songs. So a lot of songs beyond, these are like the movies, but there's a lot more than movies that they worked on. So
yeah, this is the highlights, but yeah, there's many more, much more.
Right.
But unfortunately, after Walt's death in 1966, they ended up leaving the Disney company, because basically what I rewatched a documentary about them, and what they were saying is basically after his death, the work just dried up. Nobody was calling them anymore. So it was basically Walt that was keeping them busy.
Right.
And some people at the company also resented them because they were so close to Walt, and Walt, you know, felt, you know, he called them the boys. They were very close. They worked close together, and some people resented them for that. So they were there with the company for a little bit, but then after a while, they're like, we're not doing anything, so let's just go out on our own and work freelance as songwriters.
Right.
And by doing this, they would go on to compose scores for motion pictures, television shows, theme park exhibits, and stage musicals. So we're going to talk about all that stuff, too. Mm-hmm. But their first non-Disney assignment came from Robert R. Cubby Broccoli, which if you know anything about the James Bond movies, he's a name that is synonymous with the James Bond movies.
It's also synonymous with beef.
Broccoli?
Yes, beef and broccoli.
I know, it's a funny name, but he just, you know, he owned all the rights to the James Bond movies, and so he was the one, you know, basically all the movies that you've seen, except for maybe a few of the newer ones, he was involved in that. And, you know, he was the one producing the movies, making them happen. But apparently he also owned the rights to another story called Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. And he called the brothers up 1968 and had them write some music for this film. And this garnered the brothers their third Academy Award nomination, this film, and the music for this film.
A lot of people who are not Disney-centric confuse this film as being a Disney film.
Right.
Because it definitely seems like it is, and it has Dick Van Dyke in it.
Right.
Basically playing the same part he played in Mary Poppins.
Right.
And the music sounds Disney because it was written by the same people that wrote all the Disney songs during that time. So
right. So yeah, I mean, and there's the difference with this movie though is Dick Van Dyke is like the main character, he's not in Mary Poppins, but he has some amazing dance sequences in this film. So if you haven't seen it, you definitely need to check it out. And the old bamboo is just an amazing, you can really see what type of a entertainer he was in that.
Also, they originally asked Julie Andrews to come back to play Truly Scrumptious, the female lead, but she turned it down.
Yeah. So that was their first one. And then, but also, before they left, they had started working on projects. You know, this was also before Walt passed. That they needed to finish. So they still had these obligations, even though technically they were freelance writers. Mm-hmm. So what these projects were is The Aristocats from 1970, Bedknobs and Broomsticks, 1971, Winnie the Pooh and Tigger 2, 1974. And then they wrote a new theme song for the Carousel of Progress when it was moved from Disneyland to Walt Disney World in 1974. Mm-hmm. Which is called The Best Time of Your Life. And then they wrote songs for Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh, which is the film of all three shorts put together. Mm-hmm. And then for Winnie the Pooh and A Day for Eeyore from 1983. Mm-hmm. So some of the other stuff that they did, which was non-Disney projects during this time, they wrote music for a film called Goldilocks. It came out in 1971.
With Bing Crosby.
That was animated, right?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
And
that was
Paul Winchell. Bing Crosby and Paul Winchell. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows who Bing Crosby is. Paul Winchell was the original voice of Tigger.
Right.
And he provided a voice for this. I haven't seen it, but I'm interested knowing.
I know.
They're in it. And the Shermans wrote the music.
So. Right. Yeah. And then they did the music for Snoopy Come Home, 1972. This was animated.
Snoopy. I love that movie.
Yeah.
No dogs allowed.
So another animated
Fundamental
film.
Fundamental friend dependability. Sorry. I just love that score.
I guess you guys need to check that out if you haven't already.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
It's the best, it's the very best Snoopy Peanuts movie, I think. The very best one out of all of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another animated film, Charlotte's Web from 1973. Mm-hmm. A live-action film, Tom Sawyer from 1973. And then as a sequel to that film, another live-action film, Huckleberry Finn from 1974.
Yes, both produced by Reader's Digest, believe it or not.
Interesting. a live-action film called The Slipper and the Rose from 1976. And this was basically like a modern Cinderella story.
Well, modern in the fact that it was the 70s, but it does take place in the, you know, the olden times.
Mm-hmm.
It's not set in modern day, in other words.
Right. Okay. And then another live action film, The Magic of Lassie from 1978.
And I believe, what's his name is in that? From Pete's Dragon.
Oh, yeah.
Mickey Rooney. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, this is something that a lot of people don't know, and it's sad, so you don't really want to know, but even though the brothers worked together on tons of music, And they really did actually work together really well. They actually did not get along personally. So they had a lot of major disputes and their families hardly knew each other. So like when they would go to movie premieres, they would sit on opposite sides of the theater. They would never sit with each other. And, you know, they would do their obligatory like pictures that they needed to do for whatever, you know, magazines and stuff like that. But then they would just go their separate ways. And, yeah. You know, they both had families, they both had kids, and they grew up like blocks away and they never saw each other. Never played with each other, never hung out with each other, the kids. Even to the extent that when their father died in 1973, they actually had two separate shivas. So that's something that Jewish people do when somebody passes. They have
like a
mourning period.
It's a Jewish wake. Yeah.
Yeah. And they had two separate ones, one at each brother's house, because they could not have one together.
Right.
And it's really sad. And there's the documentary that I rewatched, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, really highlights this. And so much so that when I finished watching it, I was sad because it's just unfortunate that they couldn't overcome their differences.
Yeah, I did not want to rewatch it because it's not pleasant to
It's not. That. And it's weird because it's such a focus in that film of their differences and how they really didn't get along personally. So, even though it is still like, you know, some good information as well about them. But anyway, so their father passed away in 1973. And also in 1973, they made history by becoming the only Americans ever to win first prize at the Moscow Film Festival for Tom Sawyer, for which they also authored the screenplay.
Yes, they were not just the music writers. They wrote the book also for the musical. Yeah.
Famously. Yeah. That's so good. That kind of plays
it's
into...
It's really good. If you haven't seen it, it's my very favorite version of the Tom Sawyer story.
Mm-hmm.
And it's with...
Johnny Whitaker.
Johnny Whitaker as Tom Sawyer and... Another Disney connection, Jodie Foster as Becky Thatcher.
So that kind of plays into like Robert's strength there with, you know, the screenplay and writing and things like that.
And I know Robert once said that his very favorite song that he ever wrote was the River Song from this film.
Yes, he did say that. I saw him say that in the documentary.
Oh, okay.
So
confirmed.
Yes. So outside of the music picture or the motion picture realm, they of course were also writing songs for stage musicals.
Mm-hmm.
So one of them was called Victory Canteen from 1971.
Mm-hmm.
And another one is called Over Here from 1974, and it was a Tony nominated musical, and it was the highest grossing original Broadway musical of that year. And I believe
the first one was just one of the Andrews sisters, Patty Andrews, and Over Here was all three. Patty, Laverne, and Maxine were all in it. Yeah. And it of course took place during World War II. So all the songs were like that era of music. Yeah.
Okay.
Both of them took place during World War II. Over Here is like the unofficial sequel to Victory Canteen.
Interesting. All right, so in 1976, one of the films we talked about earlier, The Slipper and the Rose, it was selected for Great Britain's annual Royal Command performance. Right. So I guess they re-released it in theaters, is that...
No. What it means is... The royal family attend a screening.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and it's a big event, and a lot of people dress up and go. And it's... They not only do movies, they do live performances and all sorts of different things. Famously, the Golden Girls were asked to come and do a live skit as a command performance for
really
the royal family back in the 80s. Yes, and there's footage of them doing a
They did it.
Oh yeah. Huh. When you're asked to do a command performance, it's a huge honor. And so it's not like it's not literally a command, but you could say, "Who do you think you are? I'm not British.
Get over here."
But it's a very big honor. So if you're asked, I mean, you would want to do it. So.
And then this movie also features they wrote the screenplay for this film as well as the music and the score.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And then that same year, the brothers received a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame directly across from Grauman's Chinese Theater. So you can still see it today, just, I guess, across the street. Mm-hmm. And there's a picture of them. Another one of those obligatory
pictures. Right across the street, I'm remembering, is a Ripley's, believe it or not, museum. I wonder if that's where their star is.
I actually think it's farther down. I don't think it's directly across the street. Because my memory is across the street from, not exactly directly, but a little bit across the street from Grauman's is the Disney's Theater.
Theater. El Capitan.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes more sense.
Yeah.
So it wasn't Disney then, but it is now.
Right, exactly. It is now. Mm-hmm. Alrighty. So they also wrote numerous top-selling songs, so just individual songs, not for a specific project. Mm-hmm. And probably the most famous song that they wrote was a song called You're 16. Mm-hmm. And this song holds the distinction of reaching Billboard's top 10 twice.
Yes.
First with Johnny Burnett in 1960, and then 14 years later with Ringo Starr.
Yeah, and the lyrics are a little problematic under today's... code of decorum.
Right.
But these are old songs, so.
Yeah. I mean, you're going to have to critique each one then if you
really could think of it as he's remember. The way I listen to it and I'm able to stomach it is I think of it as he's remembering when he was also a teenager and singing about a girl back in the days of his youth.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't think of it that way, it's a little stomach churning, but
right.
It is a very, very catchy song.
It is.
Yeah. And we're talking about Richard, so he only wrote the music, so.
Right. Not the lyrics. I mean, he did help a little bit because they would bounce off of each other.
Yeah, he was his sounding board, but yeah.
Yeah. So now we're into the 80s, and during the 80s, they wrote a few songs for Disney attractions. So they wrote One Little Spark for the Journey to Imagination, and Magic Journeys, that was for the 3D film of the same name that played in Epcot, Disneyland, Tokyo Disneyland, and Magic Kingdom.
Yes.
Specifically at Epcot, it was in the Imagination.
It premiered at Epcot. Yeah. When it closed at Epcot, a couple years later, it reopened in the Magic Kingdom at the theater where the Mickey Mouse Revue had originally played, which is the Fantasyland Theater, which is now where PhilharMagic is.
Mm-hmm.
And in Disneyland, before Captain EO opened, they started showing it there at the Tomorrowland stage. Uncovered at night, and then they covered the theater and kept playing it as an indoor theater until Captain EO was ready, and then they replaced it with Captain EO. And I think they did the same thing in Tokyo. They didn't play it in an outdoor theater, but I think the theater where they showed it, eventually they replaced it with Captain EO as well.
And I believe the same thing for Epcot as well.
Yes, when it closed at Epcot, they replaced it with Captain EO. Yes, that's true.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So another song they wrote is We Meet the World with Love. This was for Tokyo Disneyland attraction called Meet the World. And they wrote the theme song for it.
And originally this was supposed to be an Epcot Center attraction. They even started to build the theater for it behind the Japan Pavilion. But they screwed up and they built it the wrong, like the foundation was the wrong dimensions somehow. So they ended up not being able to build it without starting all over again. So they decided it was too much money. So they decided, well, why don't we just put it in the Japan park that they were working on at the same time. So it ended up going over to Japan instead.
Interesting.
Because it's about Japan, so.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. All right, so now we're going to move on into the 90s. They provided songs for the animated film Little Nemo, Adventures in Slumberland. That's from 1992. For a stage musical called Busker Alley from 1995, starring Tommy Toon, and the animated film The Mighty Kong from 1998.
Yeah, I have seen clips of Little Nemo, and it looks like a good quality type. I mean, it's not up to Disney, but it is still, it looks charming, and the characters are cute. And, but this The Mighty Kong, I feel like...
Yeah.
That's a little beneath their pay grade. I don't know why they decided to work on that. They must have been fans of the movie King Kong, so they were inspired to work on it. But it's kind of a very low budget. Not really. It's shocking that it's got Sherman Brothers songs in it.
Right.
I'm not familiar with Busker Alley. I've never heard the score, and I'm not sure what the play is about. But... just those three names are enough to pique my interest. Tommy Toon, Richard Sherman, and Robert Sherman. That sounds like my kind of thing, so
yeah,
I should seek it out. I did see Tommy Toon perform live.
Oh, you did?
When they had a revival of Bye Bye Birdie. And it came to Boston, and I saw it there. And he played the lead character. The same part that Dick Van Dyke had played originally. Albert Peterson, he played in Bye
cool.
Bye Birdie. Yeah. Anyway,
alrighty, so in the 90s, what was that?
I said enough about me.
Right. Back to the Shermans.
Yes.
So in 1990, Richard and Robert Sherman were both inducted as Disney Legends. So here's a picture of that. They put their hands in...
I couldn't find a picture of them putting their hands in the cement and or receiving the award. Maybe they didn't document it as fully as they do nowadays, because you always see pictures of that now, but maybe... This was like the third year of it, so maybe they weren't really making as big a deal out of it back then. Who knows?
Yeah, maybe. And then in 1998, their brothers published their autobiography titled Waltz Time, From Before and Beyond. And this, from my understanding, is not published anymore, but I recently just purchased a used copy of this.
Yeah.
And it is a really great book.
How much? Can I ask how much? Because I have a feeling you paid a lot, because it's probably rare.
It's not that rare. No. I paid like 60-something. Dollars for it.
Is it a big coffee table book?
Yes, it is.
Okay, then, and that seems reasonable.
It's really cool because, like, every page has a picture in it, and it's not like glossy paper. It's more like thick cardstock kind of a thing, and it really just shows all these pictures of things that you haven't really seen very often. So a lot of the pictures are also in that documentary, but it's really cool.
Do you have a scanner? You might have to send me some of these pictures.
It'll be hard because these are like 11 by 17 pages.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. But it's a really great book, so if you can pick one up, I highly recommend it.
Yeah.
It only goes, like, it was written in 98, so of course it doesn't go, you know, the last
They really had a big resurgence during the 2000s.
Right.
So it doesn't cover any of that stuff, Speaking of 2000s.
We will head towards that. So in 2000, the Sherman Brothers wrote the song score for Disney's blockbuster film, The Tigger Movie, that came out in 2000. Yeah. This film marked the brothers' first major motion picture for the Disney company in over 28 years.
Yeah.
It makes sense. You know, this is a, you know, Winnie the Pooh property, so
yeah, whenever there was something Pooh-related, they always looked at the brothers, the boys.
Right, right.
Because that was their
thing.
And
we didn't mention it in the 80s, but they did music for, like, that Winnie the Pooh TV shows that came on the Disney Channel.
The Further Adventures of Winnie the Pooh or something like that for TV, yeah.
And also, what was that one that you liked? The, was it Pooh's Circus or?
Oh, yes, from the Disney Channel.
Oh, Welcome to Pooh's Corner.
Welcome to Pooh Corner. They wrote all the songs for that, and a lot of them were songs that they had written for other things that had been unused. For example, The Right Side of the Bed was used for that, but it originally was a song written for Mary Poppins that was not used.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, we'll move on to 2002. So, with the popularity of the film Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, of course the music, the splendor of that movie, they decided to make a stage musical out of it. And so in 2002, this musical premiered in London. It was the most successful stage show ever produced at the London Palladium. And it's boasting the longest run in that century-old theater's history. So this was very popular. Of course, this is an English story, and it's being presented in London. So, of course, that's going to be a very popular thing. Also, it's family-friendly. So, and it's the same music that they wrote for the film. Mm-hmm. And then in 2003, the musical was nominated for Laurence Olivier Theatre Award for Best New Musical. Mm-hmm. And the Sherman Brothers each received the Musical Theatre Award from the Variety Club of Great Britain that year as well for the same musical. Mm-hmm. And then around this time, while they were developing the musical, you know, they were spending a lot of time in London, so and this in 2002, Robert actually moved from Beverly Hills to London. And what from that documentary, too, that they explained that his wife had recently passed, and his wife was the love of his life. And so while he was living there, you know, he just kept having all of these memories of her that he could not get out of his mind, and it was making him really sad. So he just had to get away. And so he went to London and just stayed there. It was easier for him to, you know, cope with her loss and things by doing that. Mm-hmm. So, so while he moved, you know, Robert moved to London and Richard still stayed in, you know, California area. You know, the brothers continued to collaborate musically through long distance, you know, phone, fax, email, and low-cost international television telephone service. So that's pretty much how they collaborated at this time.
This was before, you know, the internet really, I mean, it existed, but it wasn't like it is now.
Yeah. And then they also traveled between Los Angeles, New York, and London, working together on various musical plays until Robert's death in 2012. So here's another thing that they collaborated on before he died. A new Disney and Cameron Mackintosh stage musical adaptation of Mary Poppins made its world premiere in London in December 2004 and features the Sherman Brothers classic songs, including a few new songs, and the musical opened on Broadway in 2006. This was very popular.
It also includes the song I just mentioned, The Right Side of the Bed, that was originally written for Mary Poppins.
And then they used it for that Pooh show, and then they brought it back to Mary Poppins.
Yes.
Interesting. the one thing that I've heard about this musical, I always wanted to see it in person and didn't get to, but the Supercalifragilistic song, they extended it. for this musical. It's a very long, extended, like, portion where they're singing Supercalifragilistic. They spell it backwards. You know, they really go into the word. So, you know, it's for the musical. So in 2005, this Mary Poppins musical was nominated for 9 Olivier Awards. And then also in 2005, early 2005, the Chitty Chitty Bang Bang musical premiered on Broadway. So they were really doing a lot of musicals during this time. Mm-hmm. The Sherman brothers wrote an additional 6 songs specifically for the new stage production for the American version. And the musical was nominated for 9 Tony Awards for Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Then also in 2005, Richard and Robert were inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame in June of 2005. Mm-hmm. And then in 2008, Robert and Richard were awarded the National Medal of Honor, Medal of Arts, I'm sorry, for the purpose of honoring artists and patrons of the arts. And this was at the White House, and it was presented by President George W. Bush. Yes. And here's a picture of it.
And you can't tell from the picture, but Robert is using a walker. That's why he's humped over a little bit. Mm-hmm. He's not, like, that's not their size.
Yeah.
They're the same height.
Right. And then in 2009, here we go, the documentary film that I've been referring to this whole time, it's called The Boys, The Sherman Brothers Story, and this was released. And this film was directed by Richard's son, Gregory V. Sherman, in collaboration with Robert's son, Jeffrey Sherman. And I actually watched it on Disney Plus, so if you haven't seen it, and you have Disney Plus, go watch it, and you'll learn all the stuff that I talked about. But again, it is sad. Mm-hmm. But this is all filmed before Robert died, too, so it doesn't even end with, like, his death or anything like that.
Right.
One of the scenes that I found really touching in the film was when they talked about Walt. Mm-hmm. And also the impact that he had on their career, but also how it felt when he died. So that was a really, emotional part of the film there. But I like that this film was, you know, the two sons of each brother came together to make this film, which I think is why the focus is so much on their separation. And they're trying to get them to, you know, they're talking about it for basically the first time because they, you know, Richard says in the beginning of the film, like, people don't know this about us, you know, we portrayed this, like, perfect relationship, but that's not how it actually was, so.
Yeah. Yeah, when I first watched it, I didn't know any of that. I was kind of shocked by it. But.
Yeah, you're not expecting it.
Right. So.
But, okay, also in 2009, Disney released a 59-track, 2-CD compendium of their work for the studio spanning 42 years. The CD is entitled The Sherman Brothers Songbook, and this is a really great album. If you have, like, Spotify or some streaming musical service, it's on there, so you don't have to buy it. You can listen to it there. But this is, like, essential. Like, it hits all of the high points of their career, all of the songs. It has Chitty Chitty Bang Bang songs on there, you know, stuff like that, too. So it's not just
it
Disney.
It doesn't just have Disney, right?
Yeah. And then, of course, this is the latest in a string of musical compilations released throughout the years, dating back to the 1970s with their songs. But this one, the 2009 one, is, like, the longest. It has the most tracks. Mm-hmm. So you can see pictures of some other compilations that were released throughout the years.
And also, one of them I have here is a piano book.
Like a songbook, right. On March 11th, 2010, the Sherman Brothers were presented with a window on Main Street at Disneyland in Anaheim in honor of their contribution to Disney theme parks. The window states, two brothers tune makers, Richard M. Sherman and Robert B. Sherman, will write your tunes for a song. Right. Here's a picture of it. I don't think that Robert attended because he probably was not, besides living in London, he probably wasn't in good health.
Right, and also, not to put any false information out there, they did not write the song Two Brothers from The American Adventure.
Yeah. All right, and then one of the, I think this is probably the last thing that they worked on together. I'm not putting money on that, and I'm not saying it definitively.
There's actually something
that
we're going to mention a little bit later that they worked on together that has not yet been put out.
Right.
I don't know if they worked on. I don't know if they might have worked on it before this or after this.
They did.
Okay.
Yeah. They worked on it before this.
Okay.
So I think anybody can feel free to correct me, but I think this is the last thing they worked on together. They collaborated with composer John Debney on the song Make Way for Tomorrow Today for the Marvel film Iron Man 2, because that film opens with like a World's Fair type of thing with like presentations and pavilions and things like that. So that's where the whole idea for the song comes from.
Right.
And why it's included in Iron Man 2.
You can see from this picture that it was inspired by the 64 World's Fair. They even have the same globe in the, you know, in the front. You can see the globe fountain. That was at the 64 World's Fair, so.
Yep. They kind of also, in the film, they're showing like a film of Tony Stark's dad, and they kind of make him look like Walt Disney.
Yeah.
So that's also like, you know, an inspiration there. But,
yeah.
And Chris has this song on his site, so if you want to listen to it, check it out. So, in 2010 as well, the brothers received the Career Achievement Award at the Theater Museum's 2010 Awards Gala. And then in 2011, the Sherman brothers were each awarded honorary doctorate degrees in fine arts from their alma mater, Bard College. And then, as we already mentioned, Richard Sherman died in London on March 6, 2012, at the age of 86. All right, so all the rest of the stuff is all, like, Richard.
Yes. For the most part.
So,
posthumous things, but mostly Richard.
Right. Yeah. So, in 2013, Disney released the film Saving Mr. Banks. And this is a film that we talked about before, documenting of P.L. Travers, the author of the Mary Poppins books. It talks about her childhood a little bit, but really the main focus of the film is the 2 weeks of meetings that she had in L.A. in 1961 with Walt Disney and his team, and Walt Disney's attempting to, you know, coax the film rights from her grasp.
Yes, right.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, we know he did it. But in the film, the Sherman brothers are actually characters in the film because this is their real life. And the actors that played them, Robert was played by BJ Novak. He's the one on the left. And Richard is played by Jason Schwartzman. Mm-hmm. I think they are both really good in that film. So it's fun to watch it, too, because you can see like that, you know, you see this is how we really understand how difficult P.L. Travers was.
Yes.
And
she insisted that they record their meetings.
Right.
So there are hours of audio tapes. So you can really hear the real life, how terrible she was.
Right. And how they were just trying to, you know, be positive and trying to get her to agree to something. They were not getting frustrated. Of course, they were holding it in. But, you know, they're just like, just trying to see if are anything that we are doing, is that going to catch on with her?
Right.
So, also in 2013, Richard collaborated on the musical stage production of The Jungle Book, providing the musical director access and permission to adapt songs that him and his brother wrote for the film, unused songs written for the film, plus new lyrics written for the production. And before doing this, I didn't even know this existed, so.
I didn't either. It looks interesting.
Yeah.
The costumes. I guess they didn't look like animals. They just wore like clothes that sort of suggested their animal characters.
Right.
But
they
were people. Like, you can see this is obviously Ka, and you can see his costume goes like comes out of the stage and it wraps around and all, so it's like a snake coming out. And then this is obviously Shere Khan, and he has a tail.
Mm-hmm.
So looks interesting. I have never heard of it either. I didn't know that was a thing.
All right. In 2014, the Sherman brothers, alongside with their father, Al Sherman, were the subjects of a London musical concert entitled A Spoonful of Sherman, written, produced, and hosted by Richard's nephew, Robert J. Sherman. This is Robert's son. Mm-hmm. They call him Robbie. The concert received generally positive reviews, and then a CD that was produced by Nick Lloyd Webber, Andrew's son, I'm assuming, was released in 2015. And then the musical was revived in 2017 and toured in the UK and Ireland in 2018, playing 28 cities. And then, in 2015, Richard was awarded the Diane Disney Miller Lifetime Achievement Award by the Walt Disney Family Museum. And also in 2015, a television special chronicling his life, it was titled Richard M. Sherman, Songs of a Lifetime, was produced by Disney legend Don Hahn, and it debuted on PBS SoCal. And I believe I did watch this. It's hard to remember almost 10 years ago, but I
believe it's probably up on YouTube or...
Or like the PBS site
PBS
or something
site,
like that.
PBS site, yeah.
Yeah. And also in 2015, he did a lot of stuff.
That was a big year. 2015 was a big... Yeah.
So, in 2015, Disneyland was celebrating its 60th anniversary, their Diamond Celebration. And Richard contributed the song A Kiss Goodnight, which was featured at the end of the fireworks show and tied into his 2017 book of the same title from Disney Editions. And the whole idea behind this song is Walt would say, you know, these nighttime performances and things, what it would give people a kiss goodnight as they were leaving the park. So that's where the title comes from.
Yeah. Song makes me cry.
Yeah, it is. It's emotional.
Yeah.
So Richard Sherman once again collaborated with Disney for live-action films, having rewritten the song "I Want to Be Like You" for Jon Favreau's 2016 remake of The Jungle Book.
This is quote unquote live action.
Yes. Which the only live action there is the boy.
Yeah. Pretty miraculous how good it is with just him, like how good he is as an actor, because it was basically him just running around a green screen, but it's very convincing. You really believe he's interacting with these animals that were not there when he was doing it.
I haven't seen this, so is that supposed to be Baloo, that bear?
Yes. And then in the poster, that's King Louie. Mm-hmm. And then you could see Ka, the snake. But out of the remakes, this is one of the better ones, I feel.
Interesting. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe one day I'll watch it.
You might like it. I liked it, so.
You did? Okay.
Yeah.
So he also wrote three new songs for the 2018 film Christopher Robin, titled Goodbye Farewell, Busy Doing Nothing, and Christopher Robin, and the last two performed by him. And you can actually see when you watch this movie, the end credits is him singing Busy Doing Nothing. Mm-hmm. And it's so emotional to watch. Mm-hmm. I remember like that was like my favorite part of the movie, even though this movie is really good.
And it's only like 90 seconds long.
Right.
Yeah.
But it was so good to end that film that way. Mm-hmm. Because like you think of Winnie the Pooh, and synonymous with Winnie the Pooh is those songs, which is Richard and Robert Sherman. So I really think that's a good way to honor him. Mm-hmm. And also in 2018, he acted as musical consultant for the film Mary Poppins Returns, which is the sequel to Mary Poppins. So he actually didn't like write any music, new music for it or anything like that. That was all other people. But he consulted on the music to make sure that it was like in the same vein as Mary Poppins.
Right.
And then one more thing in 2018, another big year for him. The Walt Disney Studios in Burbank, California, renamed Soundstage A. It's now called Sherman Brothers Stage. Mm-hmm. And that must be why Ewan McGregor is in this picture, because it was around the same time of Christopher Robin, and he played Christopher Robin.
Right.
So that makes sense.
Who's
all right,
other
so,
guy, Lex Luthor?
I don't know. I think he must be like a executive or something.
Yeah.
So throughout the mid to late 2000s, Richard would make many appearances at Disney events, speaking about the brothers' experiences working with Walt Disney and how they wrote their famous songs. And that was, I put this in here because I actually did see him in person doing just this, you know, talking about how they came up with It's a Small World at one of the D23 Expo with
I know he also famously appeared at Disneyland in 2014 for the, I think it was the 50th anniversary of It's a Small World. Yeah. And he played it live, and he was in a cavalcade. I have a couple pictures of that.
That's cool. Yeah, I mean, he would really, like, he was one of those people that whenever there was a Disney event, you would more than likely see him at them. So that was really, it helped like the fans, you know, get like, I don't want to, I'm like another word for access, because, you know, you don't think that, that you would be able to meet him because he's, you know, Disney royalty basically, but him going to these places and just being able to, you know, be with the fans, it was really cool to have that experience. And then this is kind of not so much Richard, but a little bit. So Robbie Sherman, that's Robert's son, he founded the Sherman Theatrical Entertainment that was born in 2020 with the mission of continuing the Sherman family's unrivaled 100-year musical legacy and bringing it to audiences in an exciting, contemporary, and compelling way. So Robbie was the one who came up with that spoonful of Sherman. So I think from that, he kind of came up with this whole company to, you know, continue using the Sherman Brothers songs in a way.
He's been somewhat active within Disney circles in the past few years. He wrote a song. He's been writing music, too, and he wrote a song for the Disney Anna convention. Which sounds very much like a Sherman Brothers song. His music's very Sherman Brothers-esque.
Yeah, so he's kind of like keeping the legacy alive.
Right.
In 2023, Richard wrote a new song with composer Fabrizio Mancinelli for Disney legend Andreas Deja's animated short, Mushka. And the song is entitled Mushka's Lullaby, and it was sung by an acclaimed soprano, Holly Sadios, who I've never heard of. But I didn't even know this existed until doing this.
I didn't either.
And it's not Disney, but Andreas Deja worked at Disney.
Yeah.
Obviously, and Richard Sherman did too, so.
You can tell from this picture that it's not quite the Disney look. It's got a little different look to it, but similar but different.
Like, the face structure is similar to Disney, but, like, it looks very sketched out rather than, like, completely
it
animated.
It looks more like the old, like, the Bronze Age animated films, you know, when they had that sketchy look to them.
With the watercolor background.
Yeah. Well, more I'm talking about the sketchy look of the Xerox process. From 101 Dalmatians up to about probably the Black Cauldron, they all had this sketchy quality to them. the animation because it was using the Xerox process.
All right, so also in 2023, the Sherman Theatrical Entertainment Team, they teamed up with independent film producer Niels Juhl to develop the animated musicals Incus the Ramphorhynchus. And this is a story about a small flying dinosaur for screens. Now, back in the 60s, the Sherman Brothers released like an EP, so it was like four songs that they wrote about this character that they were the ones who created this character. And then they released that album. And so to continue the legacy on, you know, the Robbie and his company, they want to develop this into an actual film, like an animated film. So Incus will feature songs written by the Sherman Brothers and has the bittersweet distinction of being the first and last full musical created by songwriting duo Richard Sherman and Robert Sherman. And the screenplay is written by the Sherman Brothers and by Robbie Sherman. So he's supplementing what they haven't written already. And my understanding is that it's still in development. I don't know if any, I couldn't find any information about where the in the process this is, but
yes, you know, this is a future release. It hasn't been released yet, so don't look for it yet.
Right. And so, also in 2023, Walt Disney Animated Studios, Animation Studios, was celebrating its 100-year anniversary, and so they produced the short Once Upon a Studio, and Richard returned to Walt's office, the same place that he and Robert would often perform Feed the Birds for Walt on Friday afternoons, to play piano in a key sequence on the short. So you can watch this on Disney Plus, and I don't know what key sequence he's playing. Is there like a Mary Poppins sequence maybe, or I'd have to rewatch it.
Yeah, I've seen it also. I don't remember. I didn't even remember him being in it, but
right. But, I didn't either.
Yeah, it must be Feed the Birds. I thought that was interesting. It must be Feed the Birds.
Yeah.
At some point. Yeah.
So Richard and his wife Elizabeth, her name was Ursula Elizabeth, so I think they kind of called her Ursula and Elizabeth. They were married for over 67 years, and they lived in Beverly Hills. And Richard died of age-related illness at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center in Los Angeles on May 25th, 2004, at the age of 95, just 18 days before his 96th birthday. Richard, one of the most prolific composer lyricists in the history of family entertainment, along with his brother Robert, garnered 9 Academy Award nominations, winning 2 Oscars for his work on the 1964 classic Mary Poppins, won 3 Grammy Awards, and received 24 gold and platinum albums over the course of his 65-year career. And I want to end it here with a quote that I think really kind of sums up how we all feel about Richard, and this is from Bob Iger. Richard Sherman was the embodiment of what it means to be a Disney legend, creating along with his brother Robert the beloved classics that have become a cherished part of the soundtrack of our lives. From films like Mary Poppins and The Jungle Book to attractions like It's a Small World, the music of the Sherman Brothers has captured the hearts of generations of audiences. We are forever grateful for the mark Richard left on the world. So there we go. That's our Richard Sherman's life. Not by any means complete, but, you know, just highlighting a lot of the things that you may not know about him.
Well, on that uplifting note, we're ending this month's episode. This could be our final Dateline for this year. We have not yet decided if we're doing a December episode or not. So that's still a question mark. So you might not see our Dateline until 2025, or you may see us again on Dateline in 2 months. But we will have another episode of our audio show and 2 more episodes of our music series. So this isn't the end. We still have more content coming for this year. So, Ruthie, where can everybody find Jiminy Crickets on the web?
You can listen to all of our past shows, including audio versions of Dateline Jiminy Crickets, on our website, jcricketpodcast.blogspot.com. You can also listen to us on Apple Podcasts under the name Jiminy Crickets, that's with an exclamation point, and be sure to leave us a 5-star review, which helps to promote the podcast. On our YouTube channel, we share updates to the Disney Chris website, including the Disneyland Magical Audio Tour, as well as past episodes of the Jiminy Crickets podcast and Dateline Jiminy Crickets. You can find our channel if you search for DisneyChris.com, and remember, .com is spelled out D-O-T-C-O-M, and don't forget to subscribe and click on the notification bell. You can also join in the conversation over on our Facebook page, Jiminy Crickets Podcast, where you can not only interact with Chris and me and all the fellow cricketeers, but you can also stay up to date on the latest details of our many worldwide web endeavors. On Facebook, Chris can be found under the name Chris Lyndon, that's L-Y-N-D-O-N, as in Lyndon Johnson, and on Threads, we can be found at DisneyChris_JC_podcast. If you would like to contact the show with your comments or questions, our email address is DisneyChris@gmail.com. We would love to hear from you.
And I'm over on Twitch now, and every week I do a live Twitch stream Thursdays at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern. We do a 3-hour show, and we listen to vintage up to contemporary Disney tunes from the parks and the movies and everything in between. So be sure to join me over there every Thursday, and it's DisneyChris_audio_fun over on Twitch. And speaking of Twitch, I have a Facebook group for my Twitch stream, which is called Disneyland Audio Fun. And if you just do a search for Disneyland Audio Fun, you'll find our Facebook group, and you can become a member of the group and chat with our other Twitch stream fans. On Instagram, both Ruthie and I have a shared account called DisneyChris_JC_podcast. And over there, every day, almost every day, I post just fun, colorful, vintage Disney images. Interestingly, I've noticed that non-park related images get a bigger reaction. When I post pictures of Disneyland or whatnot, I don't get as many likes. When I post just like vintage pictures of Disney characters and just things like that, I get like a lot more likes. And also, if I ever post anything with a picture of Walt Disney, that goes berserk. So that's sort of the... I always thought it would be the other way around, that the parks would get more of a, you know, reaction. But I guess for the average person that's out there, they're more interested in just the regular Disney stuff. But regardless, I do post all stuff, parks and characters. And then I also post anything that's an update to what's going on with our podcast, with what I'm doing on my website, like if new content has been uploaded, if a new episode is available. I also promote the stream on there. So it's about 30%, 70%. 30% is promotion, letting you know what's coming up on the show. And then the 70% is just fun images that are just posted for you to look at and enjoy. And it's not promoting anything. I've also noticed that when I try to promote something, it gets a lot less interaction. My website is DisneyChris.com. And over there, I have over 3,000 tracks that are focused on the original Disneyland park. And I have 1,000 or more songs also that are just a timeline of Disney music from 1928 up to 2024. I do have a few songs from this year now. And also, I post a song of the day every day of the year. We have a featured song that you can listen to. So it's a very music-focused website. And it's also sort of the central focus of the stream, because I use the website as sort of a conduit for how I present my stream. We listen to music from the site as part of the stream. If you'd like to support Ruthie and I, well, mostly me, on Patreon for all the work that we do, to provide free content, and it'll always be free. We're not charging for what we've always presented for free. You can go support us on Patreon at patreon.com/DisneyChris. For as little as $1 a month, you can really help us out, and we also will send you, in return, a lot of free content that's definitely worth more than $1. So you're definitely getting your money's worth. And the more you contribute, the more content you get. We have a $1 tier, a $5 tier, a $10 tier, and then our gold, what do we call it? The gold star tier.
The conscience, isn't it? Gold conscious or something like that? The star that Jiminy Crickets gets?
Yeah, it's official conscious.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's, that's for our $25 and up. And if you do the $25 every 6 months, if you continue to contribute, I send you one chapter from my Disneyland audio tour, which is definitely worth if you can afford it. But if you can only afford $1, that every little bit helps, and we will show our gratitude with rewards for whatever level you're able to contribute, and much appreciated. If you're not interested in doing a continuing donation, but would like to donate something one time only, you can do that as well on PayPal. And if you're also not really into the Patreon setup, but you are comfortable with PayPal, you can set up a monthly donation also using just PayPal. And if you choose to do that, of course you will get the same rewards depending on your donation level that we would offer you through Patreon. So you have a different option if you're not comfortable for whatever reason with Patreon. And also, again, you can make a one-time only donation on PayPal. And also, we have merch, and our merchandise has one of two logos that I designed. And you can get t-shirts, buttons, stickers, towels, beach towels. Somebody that is a fan of ours ordered two onesies for her little girl recently. So there's lots of stuff with our emblem that you can pick. And if you are interested in those optional ways to help support our show, you can go to the donate tab on my website, or just type in disneychris.com/donate, and that'll bring you to the page where you can link to all the different ways you can help support our show. Ooh! Did that come through? So that ends our look back at Richard Sherman. We've been working on this since July. Mm-hmm. We were originally going to do this in July, but we just kept... other things kept coming up, and then we both had some health issues, and we had some losses that we were dealing with and things like that. So I'm glad we finally got around to it. Yeah. And so we will see you all real soon, maybe in December, maybe in January. But we'll definitely be presenting another regular episode audio show and two more music shows this year. So look for us on our regular feed. And we'll see you all real soon. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.
Now it's time to say goodbye to all our company. M-I-C.
See you real soon.
K-E-Y.
Why? Because we like you.
M-O-U.